three, two, one. Hi everyone, this is Carla from Artifier.
And Fia from Alloy Curatorial.
And today we're at Hot Dogs on a very special mission.
Today we're here to see Pulitzer Prize winner and champion of artists, Jerry Saltz, who's come to Toronto to talk to us about his new book, How to Be an Artist.
A couple of weeks ago, we asked our followers on Artifier what we can ask Jerry Saltz if you had a minute with him. So we have three questions that you submitted and we will be asking Jerry in a few minutes.
Hi Jerry,
hey,
so
Fia.
Your book title is How to Be an Artist.
Right.
What inspired you to write this book and what can we expect from it?
I am a failed artist. If you want to see what failure looks like, this is it. I have no degrees, did not go to school, didn't start writing till I was in my 40s, was so miserable and so afraid, like most of your listeners right now, that I wouldn't get to work. Finally, I did. I became an artist, and after a while, I quit. I soon became an art critic, didn't start writing till I was 41. And I wanted to share the subsequent 30 years I've spent in the art world, around art, looking at art, loving art, being around artists, listening, watching, experiencing my own daily terror of writing, because have you've written, it's the worst thing in the world, right?
Oh, yeah, don't get me started.
Yeah, no, we're gonna, two writers are gonna start crying. So I wanted just to share how to have a life lived in art. This book will not help you make money. If we knew about that, we really wouldn't be here. But it will help you get through the daily life of being an artist.
Who can't use a little solidarity?
Amen. Amen. I could have used some at 3 a.m. I was thinking, well, I have this deadline. How am I going to really do it? You on your way here were thinking, well, I don't know about this question or that question. Everybody's the same. Everybody is the same. We all have demons. We all got here miraculously. And we're all very lucky to be.
Agreed. Thank you. All right, so let's ask you a couple of the questions that our followers want to ask you. So we've got from I'm Greg, I'm Gred. He asks, do you think that the global art market favors conceptual pieces or work that is more visually dense? So I'm guessing more detailed and more representational.
Right. Right now we're living in an art world that is very bifurcated. In one way, there's the biennial museum, atrium, mega show aesthetic. Now that favors a couple of things. One is a social activist kind of art. That's usually more conceptual, oddly enough, than visual. Sometimes that's a huge problem, artists, because you might say, this painting is about the diaspora of the Lebanese from the Syrians or something like that, but it might not be in the work. It has to be in this ridiculous long press release. And I would say to them, very bad. You have to get it in the work. Then there are, thank God, more women and artists of color than ever before. This means more mediocre women and more mediocre artists of color. Critics your age listening to this aren't allowed to say that. But here's what I think. For the last 50,000 years or so, mediocre men have been given careers. And what happens over history is we sort it out. So yes, there's going to be mediocre women and men and artists of color coming in great numbers right now, but you all will sort it out when you're my age and you'll get rid of the mediocre ones. So, me, personally, I don't like a big, huge, overproduced things. I never know who they are for, and they don't feel that personal. It's nothing wrong with making a kind of public art.
Who they are for, that's interesting.
But I like a smaller painting or sculpture, something I can almost walk around in a more private experience. But again, I don't say it's better.
Yeah.
So make anything you want, public, private, conceptual. Every work of art is conceptual. Every visual work of art is conceptual. And every conceptual work is visual. So we don't have to make any more categories.
I love that. Okay, second question from @Rumelo. She wants to know about the line, this kind of follows up in that. What's the line between commercial art and fine art these days? It seems trickier than it was before to discern.
Well, I think that's a great observation.
Yeah.
Like, you don't even know, what is Jeff Koons at this point? Is that commercial art? Is it the art of the insane? Is it the art of the 1%? I would say that is yet another differentiation that we don't have to worry about, that it's like what the Supreme Court judge said about pornography. I know it when I see it. And so when you see purely commercial art, like a Hallmark greeting card, or Thomas Kincaid, if you know who that is, the painter of light, you go, it's beautiful schlock, you know?
Yeah.
And if that's your taste, that's okay, but then, you know, we play blood sport. So I would say we all know it when we see it, and every bit of art is a little bit commercial. Every bit. Even if I just do this. That private dance that I just did for us in public, that just was consumed. So.
Well, we love you. We really love you.
We love you back so hard I can't even tell you.
Okay, so third.
I can't write if writing is without all of you.
Agreed.
And really. Please read me, even if you hate me.
Agreed.
Okay,
third question from
These
Daniela
are good
Gorley.
Questions, kids.
Okay. Daniela Gorley asks, which first show or exhibit left a long-lasting impression on you?
Well, I'm old, and I've lived through a lot of different art worlds. I know that I had a student at the Rhode Island School of Design named Kara Walker. Do you know this name?
Yes, of course.
A great artist.
She's phenomenal.
Phenomenal. Won a MacArthur plaque, does
cutouts,
silhouettes of slavery.
Incredible installation pieces. Beautiful work.
She was a student of mine at RISD, or I knew her as a student at RISD, and I remember looking at her work back then, and just looking, and the back of my head caught on fire with terror, excitement, and I knew instantaneously that I had seen one of the futures. And I knew also to offer no advice, to say nothing, to keep my distance, that whatever genius she had, good or bad, was not something I wanted to get in the way of in any way, shape, or form. I will admit to another first-person show like that at almost the same moment in time. This would have been around 1990, when things are falling apart, like now, when the money is going away, when people are scared, when they start hating each other. This was at the end of AIDS in America. It was Ronald Reagan, conservative. Different than now, because now is frankly harder, more complicatedly messed up. It was easier to go, what's right and wrong? Now it's hard. I saw an artist named Matthew Barney. He's a performance artist, and I had the same experience. What I would say to everybody is, be artists of modern life. Make art for now. Don't worry about the past. Don't spend all of your time trying to be faithful to this or that great movement. Move on. Turn the page. Make it out of yourselves. This is your time. The old time is over. It was great. 50,000 good years of white men. We did okay. Penicillin, Michelangelo, you know, birth control. We did fine. But now, our time is over. It's your time.
Well, thank you so much.
Thank you, thank you, thank you. And keep following this site. If you build it, they will come. If you write it, they will come.
Thank you so much, Jerry. We can't wait to hear more and join the rest of the crowd.
Thank you. Let's shake elbows, okay?
In the time.
The new social distancing is working quite well for us. Goodbye.
Bye. Mwah.